Francisco Sketch Fest. My name is Jesse Hawthorne Ficks. This is MiDNiTES4MANiACS celebration and salute to the legend, Peter Bogdanovich, who is in the house. Can we give it up for this? Now, as he slowly makes his way over here, I know there's a lot of
blue men from New York.
Yeah. We're really thankful that you were able to make it. I know that many of you in this room know who this legend is, and he's part of the new Hollywood of the 1970s. And there are a few of you, especially students that I've been teaching in my courses, or people who have perhaps grown up with modern films and filmmakers, that do not know who Peter Bogdanovich is.
What?
You've outlasted many generations of film history here, and tonight we're going to celebrate two films, 45th anniversary of the ultimate San Francisco treat, What's Up Doc? And following that, for any of you that didn't know, you get a special co-feature, the 25th anniversary of Noises Off.
This is a very funny play that I didn't screw up.
And Peter was worried there's going to be too much laughter tonight with both of these movies. And I want to briefly introduce this because you're going to have a longer Q&A between the two films. But after you sincerely changed film in 1971 with a lot of picture show. I'm so curious, what would make you make this film, What's Up Doc, a screwball comedy?
Well, what happened was Barbara Streisand was offered a picture by Warner Brothers called The Glimpse of Tiger, and she was thinking of doing it, my agent suggested me, and Barbara and the head of Warner Brothers, John Cowell, came over to see an early print of Last Picture Show, a work print. And Barbara loved it, and she said, I want to do a picture with this guy. And I didn't like the script that they offered me to do, and I turned it down. So John Cowell called me into his office, and he said, Peter, Barbara really wants to make a picture with you. I said, well, I don't want to do this script, John, I don't like it. I'd be happy to do a picture with Barbara. He said, all right, if you had to make a picture with Barbara Streisand, what would you do? And I said, oh, I don't know, it's the screwball comedy, you know, Daffy Dames, Stuffy Professor, she screws everything up, it all turns out okay. Like bringing a baby, you know. He said, fine, do it. So that was how it started. And within 15 minutes, I was producing and directing Streisand's next picture, and nobody knew what it was, except that I, you know, what I sketched out just now. And he said, who would you get to write it? And I said, Ben and Newman, used to work with them at Esquire, and they had written Bonnie and Clyde, and they were friends of mine. And so he said, great, hire them. So I called them and I said, told them what the situation was, and they said, well, we've only got 3 weeks because we're supposed to do another picture or something. I said, well, if Howard Hawks and Ben Heck can write Scarface in 11 days, we should be able to do this, should be able to do this in 3 weeks. Well, it couldn't do it in 3 weeks, but we did a draft that was okay. And then I did a sort of polish, which was almost a fair. And I had to get Barbara and Ryan to commit to the script. And I knew that if they read it, they probably wouldn't think it needed work, which it did. So having been an actor myself, I figured the best way to do this is to have them read it with me. Because then they'll be worrying about whether they're impressing me or whether I like them or not. And they won't notice that the script is slightly inferior. So that's what we did, and they loved it, and I kept laughing loudly at everything they said. And they agreed to do the picture. And then John Cowley called me and he says, do you think the script needs work? I said, yes. He said, how about Buck Henry? And I said, Buck would be great. So I hired Buck. And I had one meeting with Buck, Musso and Friends, a famous old Hollywood restaurant. And he said, I said, what do you think? He said, well, you're going to hate me, but I think it's not complicated enough. And I said, well, you think we need a fourth suitcase? We had three suitcases. I said, you think we need a fourth suitcase? He said, yeah. So at that time, Daniel Ellsberg had stolen the Pentagon Papers. So I said, okay, well, let's make it Daniel Ellsberg. The Pentagon Papers would be the fourth suitcase. And then I said, go ahead and start writing, Buck. So about 2 weeks later, I called Buck. I said, how are you doing? He says, terrible. I said, why? He said, I've lost one of the suitcases. I don't know what the goddamn thing is. We didn't want to cheat. We wanted, if people saw the picture again, we wanted it to be fair, so we didn't cheat with the suitcases. So they really are, they're in the right place. And anyway, we made the picture, it was a lot of fun. We shot all the exteriors in the picture were shot here in San Francisco. They got very annoyed with us, and then Herb Cain wrote a nasty piece on the Sunday paper. Because we wrecked some stairs.
You messed up more than just some stairs.
Well, mainly the stairs were pretty bad, but Warner Brothers came and patched it up a little bit. But this was the only movie I've ever made on a dare. What would you do if you had to do a picture with Barbara Streisand? That's like a dare. And this is what we came up with. Now, interestingly enough, I had been offered a picture called The Godfather, and I wasn't particularly interested in the mafia, so I turned it down. And at the end of 1972, the top grossing film of the year was The Godfather. The second grossing, the top grossing film was Poseidon Adventure. And the third was What's Up Doc? So I didn't do so bad. And unless you have some more questions.
No, I'm going to hold those for our bigger event that follows the film. But I've also put together, for the past 9 years, since the last time you were here in San Francisco, I've been pulling together every trailer of all movies that you've made in your career.
Oh my God.
And we're going to split them up. We're going to watch a handful of them before What's Up Doc, and then we're going to watch a handful of them before Noise Is Off. And I'm really excited so many of you came out during the storm here to celebrate San Francisco and Peter Bogdanovich's big return. Please give it up for the legend.
Thank you very much. John Cowley called me and said, head of the studio, he says, Casey, it doesn't just come chase. It's going to cost $1 million. I said, yeah. Can't you just think of it? We have an offer from McDonald's. If you have the cars driving by McDonald's, I said, they could go to a drive in McDonald's and wreck the whole joint. No, I don't think they could do that. No. Oh my God, that's exhausting watching it.
Now, this movie continues to work. I mean, it's going to work forever. And I want you to talk about screwball comedies. Because many of us who have fallen in love with film history probably went through you to get back into our talks or Ernst Lubitsch. And many times we forget about them. So if it was the Warner Brothers cartoons that many of us grew up with, or now your films, or now Wes Anderson and Noah Baumbach, I want to go all the way back to the beginning of screwball comedies. Why did you fall in love with them?
Well, they're so funny. And they're so screwy. I like those kind of pictures. The 30s, mainly in the 30s, although Preston Sturges made a few in the 40s. Then it sort of died out during World War II. I don't know why it died out, because we still needed it, but it died out. That's what I bring back. I just love screwdrivers.
How did you first fall in love with them?
I don't know. I just, Hawks made some great ones. 20th Century is amazing. Bringing up Baby, I guess, was the one that knocked me out. Even though it wasn't a hit in its day, it's funny. It was successful in some places, but not others. And I saw it three times the first time I saw it.
Where were you?
In New York. The New Yorker Theater was playing it. We revived it in a series called The Forgotten Film. And they hadn't played New York for years. And I went, I couldn't believe it. Just couldn't believe they did that. And then I saw, the Lady Eve and by Preston Sturges and Hawks's His Good Friday. His Good Friday isn't really a screwball comedy, but it was sort of in between. But there's just, there's my man Godfrey. In fact, the phrase screwball, I can't see you guys, the lights are so strong. There you go. Screwball, the phrase screwball comedy came from a variety review of My Man Godfrey, where they said, Carol Lombard is a real screwball, or something like that. And that's where it came from. What else? Preston Sturges, Miracle of Morgan's Creek, have you seen that? That's a amazing film. It's an amazing film. That's the last game. Palm Beach Story.
So, the new Hollywood is happening in the late 60s and early 70s, and you're unlike any of the other filmmakers of the era. You're always making movies in a different period from classic Hollywood. How did you stay your own person during this time?
I don't know. I don't know. It's a deep dish question. I don't know if I can answer. But I know one thing. When we did this picture, we tried to avoid any contemporary reference, because I didn't want the picture to date with jokes about Johnny Carson or something like that. The only slightly contemporary line is when she says, love means that I never say sorry. Because that's the love story reference, which was funny because Ryan was in Love Story. But I think the line would work even if you didn't know that, because she does the blink with the eyes. It was very funny because I came over to her about 2 weeks before we were going to shoot the scene, and I said, I want you to do it like this. Love means that I'm going to say you're sorry. She said, with blinking. I said, yeah. Why? I said, I don't know, if it takes the heat off the line. It sort of shows that you're kidding. Well, she went over to Ryan and she said, what do you think is funny? Love means that I'm going to say you're sorry? Or love means that I'm going to say you're sorry? And Ryan said, I don't know, whatever Peter thinks. And then she went to everybody on the crew. And she said, she kept asking everybody, she said, gee, I don't remember. So finally, the day we were shooting, she said, let's shoot it two ways. I said, no. She said, why not? I said, because if we shoot it two ways, from now until forever, you're going to say, we should have gone the other way. Just leave it with the blank. She said, you're impossible. I said, I know, but you love me. I did love her. She's wonderful in the picture. Isn't she great? And she looks so good. Laszlo really let her do it. And that shirt, I like that shirt she wore. I bought by her. And the hat. Polly did a great job of designing her clothes, that white outfit she wears. Anyway, and Ryan, this is before Ryan became not so pleasant. He was really, really good. He really paid attention and worked hard at that. I mean, he'd never done anything like it. He did very well. He was actually doing me, doing Cary Grant.
Can you do that? Can you do Ryan doing Cary Grant?
Well, you know, Ryan was doing me doing Cary
Grant. Yeah, do it right now.
Well, you know what I mean.
I don't.
But it's got those tapes, you know.
What happened to the guy that falls on the table?
That was, can't remember his name. His last name is Baxley. I think it was Paul Baxley. He was the son of the guy that drove the VW bug into the water.
The rubber's obviously wasn't Barbara Ryan.
And unlike the movie, the thing just sank like a stone. And we were all waiting for him to come up. He was what's known as a water man. He was used to doing stunts in water. But he didn't come up for a couple of minutes. We were all very worried. I sent some frogmen down to try to find him. And it was all muddy. I mean, mud. But they couldn't find him. He finally came up. We were just desperate. And I said, what happened? He said, the windshield came in on me. And the door wouldn't open, it was stuck in the sand and the mud. I said, how'd you get out? Through the windshield. That was a nervous moment. The other most nervous moment was when the guy who was standing up in the back seat, the last car that he was flying off that way. I can't remember, Lauren, his name was. And they brought him up, he was out. They brought him up and he came to and he said, when do we do it? We could not remember doing it. We had to run it for him to prove that we had done it. Luckily, nobody got hurt. One guy, I think, broke his ankle.
Now, those steps are still busted up.
Well, they refixed them up. One brother sent a crew to fix them. They were very angry with us. But your city was very hospitable to us, actually.
Now, do you have permits?
I think so, I hope so. We think the cops didn't come after us, but maybe they did. No, I don't think they did. You know, when I called Carrie Grant, a friend of mine at that time, a friend of mine who did die, one of them, the Larrys, I called him and I said, guess what? My new picture is opening at the Radio City Music Hall in New York, which was the venue for family-oriented pictures, or just good pictures that the whole family could go see. And Carrie said, that's nice. I had 28 pictures play the hall. 28 pictures? Yeah, all my pictures play the music hall. I tell you what you must do. Go down there, put on sunglasses and a raincoat, you want that. But stand in the back, and you listen and you watch while 6,500 people laugh at something you did, it will do your heart good. And I did, and it was like a mainline injection of joy. It was really wonderful seeing those people laugh, and it was great. And I thought about it later, so I wonder how many times Carrie went for those 28 pictures and put on her raincoat and sunglasses to do that, to watch what people laugh. There's nothing more fun than hearing people laugh at something you did.
And you watched it tonight again. How many times do you think you've seen this?
Well, I haven't seen this picture for a while. I don't think it's been maybe 10 years since I've seen it. Because I don't like to see it by myself. I see it when there's an audience, I'll go. But by myself, just bore me at home. I know what's going to happen. It was fun to make. The chase took 4 weeks. Cost $1 million.
Now, in 1972, you had last picture shows still playing?
Oh, that's amazing. What happened was, you know, in those days, they didn't open pictures in 1,000 theaters or 2,000 theaters at a time. They opened in one theater. So the last picture show was playing in one theater in New York on the East Side, and one theater in Los Angeles, one theater in Chicago, one theater in a few other cities. And What's Up, Doc? Opened in March of 72. So last picture show was still playing on the East Side. So I had a picture on the East Side, a picture on the West Side. And we had two pictures in the top 10 variety for quite a while. That was what I would call glory days. Glory days.
Now, you're a Serbian Jewish boy growing up watching movies. Did you ever think you would be here? This amazing career you've had for an entertainment 60 years?
God, has it been that long?
You started acting at a really...
15, yeah. Well, I don't know. I figured that's what I wanted to do. And I got lucky, very lucky.
Now, watching a bunch of these trailers before both of these movies, I hope gives everyone just this massive achievement that you have done. You've consistently done in every decade with whatever difficulties you've had to overcome, you consistently work.
I don't know how to do anything else except make pictures and write a little bit. I published 14 books. I don't know how the hell I did that. I really don't. I keep having to remind myself that I've done these things, because I don't sit around and say, oh, I did this, I did that. People say it to me, I say, oh, right, that's right, I did do that. I'm always thinking of what's going to happen next. What am I going to do next?
What are you going to do next?
Well, I've got five things on the burners. I'm going to do a documentary about Buster Keaton. Talk about stupid. He was the funniest.
Yeah.
Brilliant. And I've been asked to do a documentary on him. And I've been asked to do a documentary on Douglas Fairbanks, Sr., the first great American male star, for those of you who don't know. And then I'm going to do, I'm going to try to finish Orson Welles' last film, The Other Side of the Moon. We have to edit it. It's not going to shoot anything. We just have to edit it. And that looks like it's going to happen sooner than later. And the thing I'm most excited about is a kind of comedy, drama, fantasy that I'm going to do called Wait For Me, which Brett Ratner is producing. And it's a very, I don't know, it's pretty unusual picture. Because it's funny and sad, but sometimes at the same time. And it's a fantasy because there's six ghosts in it. Friendly ghosts, not scary ghosts. And it takes place in five different cities in Europe. And bless you. And I always wanted to make a picture where it doesn't quite stop, you know. So the leading character is a movie director who's been married six times, and he's got six daughters. And his last wife, the sixth wife, was killed in a small plane crash, along with two of his best friends, 6 years before the picture starts. And he's completely screwed himself up. He's punched out a producer at Fox, and he chopped up a projection at Universal, which John Cassavetes did do, actually. And he's persona non grata in Hollywood. That's how the picture starts. And he's been traveling through Italy, conning the Italians that he's got a story, but he has to find the locations first, so they've been paying for everything, and he doesn't have a story. He hasn't got any story at all. He actually has no idea what he's going to do. That's how it starts. And it gets more complicated as it goes on, with all the six wives come into it, including the dead wife. She comes in as a ghost. And it's a strange picture. I hope it works.
It's another screwball comedy.
Well, it's a kind of screwball drama. I haven't seen any picture like it. It's strange movie, but I'm compelled to do it. So Brett likes it, and a couple of other producers like it, so we're going to do it.
I want to come back to this idea about ghosts, because there are a lot of amazing actors that you've worked with over your career, and you've outlived a lot of them. And Noises Off, even has, even though it's 1992, and I think this is the first time that it's screened in a couple decades, that's correct.
I haven't seen it in an audience in a long time. I haven't seen it in a long time.
Even in this
I hope you're not too tired of laughing.
Oh, this is SF Sketchfest. This is what they paid money for.
Well, Noises Off, I saw it on Broadway. Whenever it was, in the end of the 80s, early 90s. And I thought this was really funny. It made me laugh more. Really made me laugh. And Spielberg bought it. Spielberg's company bought it. And Frank Marshall, who was working with Steven, started with me on Targets, worked on Picture Show. He was on this picture, too. He's the guy who throws the shovel at one point. It was just a laugh, too. That's Frank. And he was, he did six or seven pictures with me, and then when I stopped making pictures for a year or two, Stephen Grafton, and he's been done everything. He produced Raiders of the Lost Ark, all the Jason Bourne movies, and he was a terrific guy. So I went to Frank and I said, I want to direct Noises Off. Is Stephen going to direct it? He said, no, I don't think so. Let me talk to him. So I talked to Stephen and Stephen said, we'd love to have Peter do it. And they all said, how are you going to do it? Because it all takes place basically in the theater. And they had done a draft, somebody did a draft where they opened it up quite a bit and took it and did a lot of things with it. And I remembered something that happened, Alfred Hitchcock told me. I asked him, how come when you did Dialing for Murder, which was a stage play, I think that you didn't open it up much, Hitch? He said, no, when you have a hit play, just shoot it. Don't try to make it cinematic. Don't open it up. All you do is have a car pull up because somebody gets out, who cares? Because if you opened it up and you changed the construction, you're destroying the very thing that made it a hit, which is the construction. It's the construction of the play makes it a hit. So I remembered that, and I thought, okay, I'm going to just do the play. And in the intermissions, we'll open it up a little bit. And that's pretty much what we did. We thought we brought in a narrator, brought Michael Caine in to do a narration, which was written by Michael Frayn, the playwright. It's a brilliant play. The trick to this was, have any of you seen Noises Off on the stage? Yeah. Well, one of the things that I thought as I watched this in on Broadway was, will the actors survive the night? Because there's running in and out of doors, falling downstairs, all this stuff. And that's part of the dynamic of watching it live, is, you know, are they going to get through this? It's wild. But how do you get that across in a movie? Because you know the movie's been made, so obviously they're intentional. And I thought, well, the only way to do it a bit would be to put that nervousness, that tension in the actors. And how do you do that? Well, shoot long, long, long takes with nine actors, and every one of them saying, I don't want to be the one that screws it up, and then we have to go back to the beginning and do it all over again. So they all get pretty hepped up, you know? And we would do, sometimes in this movie, we did something like 15 pages without a cut, with the camera going up and down and around and far and up. Sometimes when I watched this last time, maybe 8 or 9 years ago, I said, where the hell did we cut? I forgot, because there's so many long pieces. And it really did work, because it really went fast. And that's part of, you know, Frank Capra, who was a hell of a director. Yeah. I asked him, I said to him one time, how come I noticed that even in your dramatic scenes, you played it pretty fast, the dialogue goes pretty fast. He said, well, I can't do Frank Capra, I can do it for him, but it would bore him because he's stammering. I mean, it's a funny thing. I'm not doing that. But that's how you talk.
You just did that?
Yeah. And not for long. So Frank said, you know, it's a funny thing, because if you play things at normal speed, it's going to seem slow. I don't know why it is, but film seems to slow things down. So if you play it at an absolutely normal pace that you would in life, it'll seem slow. If you play it a little faster than normal, it'll seem normal. Now, if you want it to go quickly, you got to really speed it up. And so one of the tricks of doing comedies is to go swiftly. You don't have to wait till laughs like you do in the theater.
You're talking about long takes. The reason why I contacted you, I cold called you 10 years ago, terrifying. And I got a phone call back from your assistant saying, this is Peter Bogdanovich's office, please hold. And you got on in, and I wanted to play At Long Last Love.
Obviously crazy.
And At Long Last Love, I know, is
considered one of the worst films ever made.
Not the worst.
It's considered
one of the bad ones, yeah.
Consider that. I know that people really hammered you for that, and what's so remarkable about the film, it's now released on Blu-ray, is that it's so well made, and it's filled with these long takes that I think will get to see in noises off. And it's the type of skill that we often don't see in a lot of filmmakers nowadays.
Well, I'll tell you a funny story about myself. The version that was hated was not the good version. And in fact, I didn't even know that there was a good version. This is a very funny story. Maybe it's not that funny, but it's interesting. We were rushed into release on the Long Last Love, the original musical with the song by Cole Porter. And
stars Burt Reynolds and Sybil Shepherd
and Madeline Kyle is one of them, and Johnny Hillenburg. Anyway, we were rushed into release. The studio loved it and thought it was great, wanted it out. We had a booking at the Radio City Music Hall, and where it did well, actually, but it got very bad reviews. I went to New York and saw it, and I said, no, this is not right. So I recut it, and I said, I'll pay to recut it. And I think Alan Ladd Jr. let me pay to recut it. And we then put it out in that form, but it was too late, it had been panned. And then people saw it on television. And at a certain point in time, people would come up to me and say, why did that picture get panned so badly? We saw it on TV, it's good. I said, well, thank you. That's the version I cut after it got panned. Anyway, long story short, about 3 or 4 years ago, somebody calls me up and says, you know, Long Last Love is on Netflix. They're running it on Netflix. I said, really? So I thought I'd watch it and see what I thought of it. And it starts playing, and I say, wait a second, I cut this scene. How did I get back in the picture? And I see another scene, and I say, oh, I cut that scene. Why did I get it? But it's good, why did I cut it? Then a part of the song was cut out, and I said, that's better that way. And then I saw another one that was longer, and I said, that's better. Who that? What is it? But I watched the whole thing, and I called a friend of mine I knew, the Fox editorial, and I said, what is this version that Netflix is playing? Where did this come from? So he checked. It turns out that a guy named James Blakely, who was the head of Fox editorial at the time we made the movie, and who had died about 2 years before the story I'm telling you, was a big fan of Cole Porter. And in fact, as a young man, had acted in some Cole Porter shows. It turns out he went behind my back, because I had found the cut, and cut it the way he thought it would work. And guess what? He was right. So I called Jim Giannopoulos, who was the head of Fox, and I told him his story. And he said, wait, let me get this straight. You mean there's a cut that exists that you didn't do, and you like it? I said, it's terrific. He said, that's for the history books. And that's the version that's on Blu-ray. Because we showed it in Hollywood, which is screened it for about 400, 500 people. Everybody loved it. So it shows you, I just didn't have the right editor.
Now another screwball comedy that I adore, love that Long Last Love, but I also love Texasville, sequel to The Last Picture Show.
That's not quite a screwball comedy.
I think it's a screwball comedy. And
you've been really allowed. Unfortunately, the problem with Texasville is that we got screwed by the studio. It's an old story. And it's 25 minutes shorter than it should be.
How are we going to get the director's cut?
Well, the director's cut actually it was available on Pioneer Laserdisc, but nobody gets Laserdiscs anymore. And I'm trying to get Criterion to let me put it back for 25 minutes and put it out on DVD. And they say they might. I'm working on it, because that was a much better picture. We had to cut out a lot of stuff. Oh, that's a long story. The studio had promised to reissue The Last Picture Show, which hadn't been seen for many years, for 7 years, and wasn't available on home video yet. And they promised to reissue it before we released Texas Film, because there's a lot of references in the original version of Texas Film to The Last Picture Show. And if you haven't seen it, it doesn't make much sense. So we cut all that stuff out because they reneged on the, a new management came in and they reneged on the promise and they didn't release Last Picture Show. So we had to cut a lot, 25 minutes out.
Okay, so we're going to get the director's cut next year.
Hopefully next year, yeah.
Now, God Noise is off. Both of these are 35 millimeter prints tonight. I would love for you to give it up for projection. There's a bunch of trailers that you're going to see of other Peter's films that I want to stress to you. Peter loves movies and Hollywood. And whenever things are hard in life, I've always turned to Hollywood movies, not independent films or cult films, Hollywood movies that often can help. And Peter, I just want you to know that the magic of cinema is in every one of your films.
Thank you.
And they last, they work, and they last. And we have a ticket stub that I'd love for you guys to all pull out. It's like a golden ticket. Many of us grew up going in movie theaters that had real ticket stubs. And you might keep them in a little log or book, a diary. And tonight you'd be able to say you're here at the Alamo Drafthouse, newly restored, 1 year anniversary here, 100-year-old movie theater. And they would try to lure you into the movies to get you to come out. Like, they might give you, cups?
Plates.
Why are they trying to give away plates and cups?
So they can throw at each other. Scoop up comments.
And so what I wanted to do was have a good old-fashioned raffle here with Peter Bogdanovich. Standing here, he signed a bunch of movie...